ओम अज्ञानातिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाखया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमो ओम विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो हियर वी सी कर्दमा मुनि बीइंग सैटिस्फाइड विद द ग्रेट सर्विस रेंडर्ड बाय देवहूति वांटेड टू बेनेडिक्ट हर विद स्पिरिचुअल गिफ्ट्स। Those gifts which he had achieved and she was yet to achieve. And she was very happy that yes, I am going to share those gifts of my husband. And what is that gift? That gift is devotional service to the Lord and the pure love of Godhead. But then, being a woman, she is now reminding Kardama Muni that before you award me those gifts, you had also made a promise to my parents that I am going to remain in the household life only till Devahuti will become pregnant and she will have a child. Only so long I am going to remain. So this is what Devahuti is reminding Kardama Muni, that yes, I understand that you are a Mahatma, a great personality, but at the same time, you're also playing the role of a husband. So that's how you find here two things she's saying. Devahuti Ruvacha, Radham Bata, indeed, it's a great pleasure that Dvija Vrusha, you are the best of the Brahmanas. And you have certain qualities which are infallible. You are master of these mystic powers. Amogha Yogha Maya, because you are under the protection of the divine energy of the Lord. That means you are very advanced, you are a great soul, you are the best of the Brahmanas. But then she is also saying that at the same time, Bhartaha, you are my husband. And you are a glorious husband. And just like I have a glorious husband, I also want to have a glorious child. And that is, Prabhupada is saying, that is a quality, great quality for a chaste woman, to have a glorious child by a glorious husband. So Prabhupada is very nicely explaining these few of the important things which Devahuti is mentioning here. So in the purport, Prabhupada is commenting first about a great personality like Kardama Muni, who is under the divine protection of the Lord, Yoga Maya. Then Prabhupada also mentions about Devahuti reminding Kardama Muni about the promise Kardama Muni had made to the parents, that he is going to remain in the household life only till she bears a child. And then Prabhupada explains very nicely the meaning of the word stri. Here specially, because both of them are enlightened, both of them are very great devotees of the Lord, Kardama Muni and Devahuti. So much so, we will see that actually the Supreme Lord agrees to appear as their son. To have the Supreme Lord as their son, like Devaki and Vasudeva had, is otherwise not possible if one is not very advanced in devotional service. So here, Prabhupada is explaining the meaning of the word stri. Stri, Prabhupada is saying, to expand the good qualities of both husband and wife. And elsewhere we also find Prabhupada explaining the meaning of the word stri. One who expands the material enjoyment is also called stri. So it differs from what quality they are in, husband and wife. If they are in material qualities, then stri is meant for expanding material pleasure of the household life. And if both of them are advanced in spiritual life, then stri expands the good qualities. And the children, how it is expanded, the good qualities are expanded by having children who have great qualities. So these are the things which we find it is mentioned here. So this is very important to understand. Prabhupada explaining about this important word which is used by Devahuti, the expression used by Devahuti, Amogha Yoga Maya Adhipe Twai. You are the master of all mystic powers because you are under the shelter of Yoga Maya, internal energy of the Lord. If all of you remember, I think it was yesterday or day before yesterday, in Prabhupada's class we were hearing Prabhupada explains about this, what is the meaning of this marginal, correct? So Prabhupada explains there is internal energy of the Lord, there is external energy of the Lord. Internal energy of the Lord is called spiritual energy. External energy of the Lord, it is called material energy. And then there is another energy of the Lord, which is called marginal. Marginal means it has a tendency, actually it is spiritual. This is important. Internal energy is also spiritual, we are also spiritual, but by constitutional position we are minute, and thus we have a tendency sometime to give up the shelter of Yoga Maya, internal energy, spiritual energy, and come under the influence of material energy, Mahamaya. So that's why in the Vedic literature, the living entity is called Tathastha Shakti. So in that class, Prabhupada explains what is the meaning of Tathastha Shakti. So there is water, there is land, and then there is a portion of land that is also land. Portion of land which sometimes becomes covered with water. Correct? So that is just like you are in, you are walking on the beach of the ocean. So there is ocean, there is beach of the ocean, and then there is huge vast land beyond the beach. So we also find government has made a regulation. You cannot construct anything on the beach because for the safety purpose and up to certain portion where the beach can extend up to. Correct? And then beyond the beach there is vast land where people make their houses, everything, buildings comes up. So this land which is beyond the beach, we are very confident that this water does not cross that boundary and it will overpower that whole land. In the ocean there is water, but that beach land sometimes becomes covered with water and sometimes the water recedes. This is our position. That is called tathastha. So sometimes we are covered with water, that is maya, and otherwise actually our real position is to be servant of Krishna. That is our position. So a very simple definition of what is Mahatma and who is not a Mahatma is described in Bhagavad Gita. Those who are under the protection of divine energy of Krishna, Yogamaya, they are called Mahatmas. Their activities are different. And those who are under the protection of illusory energy, material energy of the Lord, they are actually called Duratma. Their activities are completely different. So here, why Kardama Muni is considered to be a greatly advanced personality? This is because he is under the protection of divine energy of the Lord. So in Bhagavad Gita, in the 9th chapter, Krishna explains this science very, very beautifully. Krishna begins by saying, who are the living entities who cannot understand spiritual life, who cannot understand Krishna? Even though personally the Lord descends in this material world, but still they cannot understand him to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Rather, they think that he is also one of the human beings. When they are informed that he is Supreme Personality of Godhead, they mistake him to be one among the human beings. So, that is in the 11th verse, Krishna explains this. Avajananti mama mudha manushim tanum ashritaha. Fools, mudhas, they cannot understand my superior nature. When I descend in this human society and I perform humanly activities, a kind of humanly activities which resembles activities of human being. I take birth, I also do my duties, everything. So they think that I am also one among the human being. Param bhavam ajananto mama bhutam maheshwaram. So these living entities, they cannot understand my superior nature. Then in the next verse, Krishna explains why these mudhas avajananti mama mudha, how these living entities actually they become fool. Mudhas cannot understand, but how do they become mudhas? How do they become fool? Why they cannot understand? What is the reason behind that? So in the next verse, Krishna explains why they cannot understand. So Krishna says, Rakshasim Asurim Cheiva Prakritim Mohinim Shritaha. Because these mudhas, they have taken shelter of that Prakriti which is attractive and bewildering. The word Krishna is using is Mohinim. So Mohinim Prabhupada translates as attractive and bewildering. So those attracted and bewildered by Rakshasim and Asurim Prakriti, they cannot understand Krishna. They cannot understand spiritual life. You see? So this is very important to understand. Sometimes we go out and preach Krishna consciousness and we find that not very easily they take up to Krishna consciousness. Even though you explain to them this material life is temporary, you explain to them there is a spiritual life, why they cannot understand? They are attracted and bewildered by material nature. So those who have become too much attracted and bewildered by material energy, they become captivated by Asurim and Rakshasi Pravritti. What is that? Material enjoyment. They want to exploit material energy. So they cannot understand. And all their plans are baffled. They are thinking they will be able to enjoy. Moga, Asha, their hopes are baffled. Everything, whatever activities they take up, they become baffled in that. Next, Krishna explains, then who can understand? Mudhas cannot understand. Why they cannot understand? They have taken shelter of bewildering energy of the Lord. They are also, see it says, Shritaha, Rakshasim Asurim Cheva Prakritim Mohinim Shritaha. Which kind of nature or energy of the Lord they have taken shelter of? Bewildering potency of the Lord, which actually makes them Asurim and Rakshasim. What is Asurim and Rakshasim? Prabhupada translates very nicely. Prabhupada says Rakshasim means demoniac and Asurim means atheistic. So this nature is what actually they have taken shelter of. Next, Krishna explains who can understand Krishna. In that, Krishna very clearly says, those who have taken shelter of divine energy of the Lord, actually they can understand Krishna. So next shloka Krishna says, Mahatmanas tu mam partha devim prakritim ashritaha. They are called as Mahatmas. They have expanded their consciousness. Mahan Atma means those who are great souls, great means who have expanded their consciousness. So, in one of his lectures, Prabhupada very nicely talks about what is the meaning of Mahatma. Prabhupada says, Mahatma means one who has enlarged his heart. Now, Kripana and Brahmana, we understand, right? Kripana means whose heart is very, very miser. And Brahmana means one whose heart is very wide. Similarly, Mahatma means, Prabhupada is saying, one who has enlarged his heart. And then what is the meaning of enlargement of heart? Somebody may question, what is this enlargement of heart? So very nicely Prabhupada explains, oh, everything belongs to God and I also belong to God. This is the meaning of enlargement of heart. You see, he is Mahatma. Mahatmanastu mam partha. My dear Arjuna, these Mahatmas are not under the control of material nature. One who thinks everything belongs to God and I also belong to God, therefore the supreme proprietor is God and everything should be engaged in his service, has the qualification of Mahatma. So what is the meaning of understanding everything belongs to God? What is the practical understanding? Practical understanding is not that everything belongs to God but I will enjoy. If everything belongs to God, then everything must be engaged in his service for his pleasure. So when one understands this, he is called as Mahatma. Mahatma is not a position or political leader. Don't think you become Mahatma by votes and then you become God. This practice is not accepted in the Bhagavad Gita. Mahatma is described in Bhagavad Gita as Mahatmanastu mam partha devim prakritim ashritaha. He has taken the shelter of superior spiritual energy. So first Prabhupada explains about what is Mahatma, one who has expanded his consciousness and understand I also belong to God, everything belongs to God and everything must be utilized in his service. That is the meaning of Mahatma. Next, Prabhupada explains about Devim Prakritim Ashritaha. He has taken shelter of divine energy of the Lord. He is under the protection of divine energy of the Lord. So there, very nicely Prabhupada explains, what does it mean? This Vedic word is called Aham Brahmasmi. Being puffed up and thinking I am Brahman, I am God is another Rakshasim understanding. You see? So, not only material enjoyment is Rakshasim, even in spiritual life, even though realizing I am spirit soul, I am Brahman, but if he is thinking I am Supreme Brahman, that is also Rakshasim. He is also not Mahatma. You see, this is very important. He is also not Mahatma. Bhagavad Gita is not describing such a personality as Mahatma. Simply he has realized Aham Brahmasmi. Here it is said, if you have become Brahman, you must show this in your activity by being an example, because you are spirit, you are not inactive. To become Brahman does not mean that I become inactive. In fact, I become more active because I am Brahman. But that activity is of different kind. What is that activity? That next Krishna describes. So now, when one has realized I am Brahman, and when one comes to this understanding, everything belongs to God, I also belong to God, and everything must be utilized in his service, then he becomes very active. What he becomes active in will be explained in the next verse. Satatam kirtayanto maam yathantascha dhridavrataha. So in the next verse, what is his activity will be described. So then Prabhupada says, although I am conditioned with matter, I am still active. And when I am purified from matter, do you mean to say my activities will stop? To become Brahman does not mean to become void. To become Brahman means having superior energy, and with superior energy, we must display superior endeavor and superior authority. In the next line we read, Bhajanti Ananya Manasaha. In the very next line, Mahatmanastu Mam Partha Devim Prakritim Ashritaha Bhajanti Ananya Manaso. So what does he do? Being in the shelter of superior energy of the Lord does not mean now he thinks, I have become God, I have become void, I have become merged in Brahman. No. What does he do, Mahatma? Bhajanti Ananya Manaso. With undeviated mind, he renders devotional service. Bhajanti means renders devotional service. This word bhaja in Sanskrit means service. Bhajanti Ananya Manaso. Without deviation means without deviation to material and without deviation to even in spiritual life. Without deviation, even to Brahman aspect or even to Paramatma aspect, is called Ananya Manaso. One who has become Mahatma is fully engaged in loving transcendental service of Krishna. Then Prabhupada explains this word Bhajanti very nicely. He says, Bhajanti means he is always engaged in my service. That is Mahatma. Laziness is not bhakti. There must be activity. And then Prabhupada explains that even in devotional service, actually the spiritual master knows how to engage us in bhajanti, in serving Krishna. This is also very important. First of all, one has to understand devotional service does not mean laziness, it is activities. And what kind of activity is very important. That is actually determined by the spiritual master. He knows how to engage his disciples properly in devotional service of the Lord. So Prabhupada is saying, if somebody says, I will chant sitting down, who will notice? I will doze and people will think I am chanting. This kind of cheating will not do. You see? So even in the name of devotional service, bhajanti does not mean thinking that I will sit down and I will just chant whole day. Because next verse also Krishna is going to explain, Satatam Kirtayanto Maam. Correct? See, until and unless these are all explained by great personalities, by the spiritual master, then we'll also think Krishna is saying Satatam Kirtayanto Maam. 24 hours you do kirtan. Correct? Ananya Manaso Bhajati. Without deviation you do bhajan, we will be thinking like that. So Prabhupada is very nicely explaining these concepts, that even in devotional service, we have to understand these things properly. For those who are interested in Krishna consciousness, it is clearly stated, they should chant 16 rounds every day. You are not Haridas Thakur, you are not able to chant all day and all night. Although it is a lofty idea, it's a very good idea. All day, all night, like Haridas Thakur, we will chant. It is something which at present you cannot do. 16 rounds of japa is the minimum requirement, and that takes no more than 2 hours. That leaves 22 hours to spend in Krishna's service. In our conditional life, this is how we should be engaged in. 2 hours in chanting, 22 hours in other Krishna's service. That is required for progress in Krishna consciousness. This is upasate. The work is there for you, just like Arjuna. Fighting is his duty. That is also Krishna consciousness. Yuddhasva mam anusmara. Krishna said, you remember me. At the same time, fight. Yuddhasva mam anusmara. He did not say simply fight or simply chant. No. See, Prabhupada is making it very clear. Krishna did not say simply fight or simply remember me or simply chant. Because in the material world this is not possible. Therefore, we must chant, and at the same time we have to work to continue this movement. This movement requires a lot of energy. You see? So this is also satatam kirtayanto maam. Anything actually which is meant to expand the glories of the Lord, this movement is meant to expand the glories of the Lord. This requires a lot of energy. So whatever work we are doing is also satatam kirtayanto maam. It is also chanting the glories of the Lord. So this is very important. Then further Prabhupada explains, Mahatmanastu mam partha devim prakritim ashrita. And in the next verse Krishna explains what are their activities. Satatam kirtayanto maam. Then yatantascha dhridavrataha. Dhridavrataha means with lot of determination. Yatanto, they endeavor with lot of determination. So devotional service means it requires a lot of determination. Next, Prabhupada also explains in that purport very beautifully. Because one may question then, okay, asuras, those who have taken shelter of material energy, they cannot understand Krishna, correct? Until they are bewildered by Maya, they cannot understand Krishna. They must have taken shelter of spiritual energy of Krishna. Mahatmanastu mam partha devim prakritim. They can understand Krishna. And then symptoms of such people are also described. Ananya manaso bhajati satatam kirtayanto mam. That is his activity. Then question is, how do we become free from that material energy? And how do we come under the protection of spiritual energy? Correct. So in that purport, Mahatmanastu mam partha, Prabhupada explains this very beautifully, how to do that. Anyone remembers one shloka from 7th chapter where Krishna explains how one can cross over this material energy? Devi mesha gunamai mama maya durattaya mameva prapadhyante maya metam tarantite. So how to overcome material energy is, just if we surrender to the Lord, the moment we surrender to the Lord, immediately actually we can cross over this material energy of the Lord. And how to surrender? One can surrender by the direction of the spiritual master. That is called sadhana bhakti. So by performing sadhana bhakti, gradually we will be elevated to the stage where we will become free from the influence of material energy, and we will come under the protection of spiritual energy of Krishna, and we will also become Mahatma. So this is very nicely explained here, and Prabhupada is saying Kardama Muni is such a great Mahatma, and Devahuti is recognizing this, that he is a great personality. But at the same time, she also understands that just like I have a great soul as my husband, similarly, I would also like to have from this glorious husband a glorious child. So that is the meaning Prabhupada is explaining in the purport, that as a stri, she wanted to expand the qualities of both husband and wife in glorious child, who will also have the same qualities as husband and wife. Otherwise, generally we understand stri means one who expands. It's called stri. In the material world, in our material enjoyment, when stri helps us to expand our material enjoyment, we become entangled in this material world. Who remembers that shloka from Bhagavatam? How stri helps us to expand into graha, kshetra, suta, apta, vitte, and then we become entangled. Ram Gopal? Don't remember. Ragottam? Pumsam striya mithuni bhavam etat tayo mitho hrida granthi rahu atha graha kshetra sutapta vitter janasya mohoyam aham ameti. Correct? Then there is another shloka in Bhagavatam, I think it is in Bhagavatam only, where it explains about how beginning from stri, we expand our consciousness in this material world. Yasyatma buddhi kunate tridhatuke swadhi kalatradishu. Kalatra means wife, adishu means beginning from wife. So then we become entangled in this material consciousness. Then we are like animal. And then we cannot understand spiritual life. So here we find, because both of them are very enlightened, and Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur also used to say this, that I can have 1,000 times sex if I am able to produce Krishna conscious children. So actually that is the real meaning of grahastha life, and that is what Devahuti is asking for, that before you bestow me love of Godhead, I also want to have a glorious child, because that is glorious for a chaste wife. So we'll stop with this. Granthra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.